call to attention. Feel the change in the air, for the ground is dry, but the clouds are overhead. When I'ma sing it again.
Amen. Welcome to church. Let's stand and worship Him. Father, we thank You tonight that You're good and Your mercy endures forever. And while we've been overwhelmed some this week by the things around us, God, we know that it's greater is He that is in us than He that is in the world. So we thank You, God, that You are here, You are now, we are in You, You are in us, and we're just going to worship You as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Have Your way in this place. And be pleased with our worship, Father. Let Your Holy Spirit have His way in our hearts and lives. Bring us to Yourself. Bring us closer to You. Reveal Yourself to us that we may know You more. God, we look to You and we won't be overwhelmed as we sing. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together.
God, I look to You.
is worthy, worthy of our praise, worthy of our worship. We are, I hope you've already been there today. I know you might have been to work, or might have been to the store, or here or there. I don't know where all you've been, but I hope this isn't the first time that you've entered into the throne room. I hope you've already been there today. I hope you've already worshiped in some form or fashion. I hope you've read your scripture today. I hope you've called on the name of the Lord and trusted Him and gotten closer to Him. But if you have neglected that, listen to me. If you've neglected that, we're not going to stay where we're at. We're not going to stay in any shame. We're not going to say, well, we'll start tomorrow. Tomorrow doesn't matter. All that matters is this very moment we worship God in spirit and in truth. So let's sing to Him right now and enter His throne room.
Holy, holy, forever the King and throne in glorious splendor.
Precious blood, we now enter into a throne room that were allowed to go. I mean, God took his own son's blood and spread it on the mercy seat in heaven, that the one on earth was a replica of the real one that was in heaven. And God was pleased with the sacrifice of his son. So don't take, I don't know if I should go. No, Jesus died so you could go into that throne room. Jesus died so you could know God. You could be forgiven of your sin, cleansed from all unrighteousness, have a personal relationship with the God, the only God, the creator of heaven and earth. So I hope tonight, I hope, listen to me, we sing with joy because our redemption is sure because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, listen to me, not Hebrews, not by the blood of bulls or goats or calves, but Jesus by his own blood entered into the Holy of Holies once and made a perfect sacrifice this evening. Listen to me, don't leave here tonight without praising the Lord for giving his life a ransom for many. He will pay off your debt, your sin debt, that which you owe tonight if you'll call upon his name. And if he's already done that, make sure tonight you bask in his glory and worship the King. I went down to the Crimson River, left my burdens on the shore. I went down a sinner, came up a saint, died with Christ, now I'm reborn. Yes, he washed me in his mercy, and he cleansed me with his blood. Now I stand complete, I have been set free, I found life there in that blood. Let's sing it out. Not the same.
Not the same. I am changed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. By his grace, I am saved. I'm his child forever. I am.
Yeah.
the blood of the Lamb, redeemed by His infinite mercy, His child and forever I am.
We overcome by the blood of the Lamb. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb. The word of our testimony. The word of our testimony. Praise You, for You are good and Your mercy endures forever. Only by the blood of Christ we have been redeemed. We have been made whole. We have been made right. We've been made perfect through the blood of the Lamb. And we place our testimony. We don't base our salvation on a moment with us, but we base the fullness of what we have through the blood of Jesus Christ. And we know because of His blood we are safe, secure, sanctified, set apart. God, You've done all these things through the precious blood of Jesus. So continue as we grow in You to reveal to us how much Your blood has really done for us, what all it is doing for us, and what it will continue to secure for all eternity. We bless You, Jesus. You hung on the cross and God elevated You to the highest place of honor with the only name under heaven given among men whereby we can be saved. So we call on that name tonight and we praise You for being a good, good Father, a good Savior. And we thank You for the Holy Spirit Himself that has brought us to You. We worship You in spirit and truth tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give Him some praise, church. Hasn't it been good tonight to worship the Father? Amen. You can be seated. Amen. Praise the Lord. Alex, who am I going? Everybody going? Where are we going? Where are we going? All right. Junior high boys, Mr. Toby, go ahead and go. Junior high boys. Junior high girls, Miss Maddie, you can leave. Junior high girls. High school boys and girls with Patrick out the back there. Nursery, Miss Alex Bailey. Toddlers, first grade, Miss Cindy. Second and third grade, Miss Tiffany. Miss Sheila Allison, fourth and fifth out this door.
Amen. James chapter 5. James chapter 5. And we're going to pray tonight. But before we pray, last night you missed a good prayer meeting. We put it on Facebook. I know it's not something that we're probably used to doing, but I want to encourage you. Every month, the first Tuesday of every month, at a different church that's involved in the Benton County Ministerial Alliance, we meet at a different church and we pray for revival. The first Tuesday night of every month. We don't pray for hurt big toes and broke arms and headaches and all that stuff. It's just that's other times. These prayer meetings are just for the glory of God to be seen on the earth. And we had a prayer meeting here last night. It lasted a little over an hour and a half. And people were weeping, confessing, begging the Lord. As the book of Acts says in Acts chapter number 4, that after their prayer meeting took place, the place shook. The literal place they were in, praying in, shook. Not the people, the building shook. And the manifest presence of God can still shake a building today if he wants to. We'll not limit our God to what we've seen him do. We'll believe what he says he will do. That's what you got to do. You can't just believe what you've seen. You got to believe what he says. And so I trust that you still believe God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and that he never changes. Amen? And that just like he shook that building in the book of Acts, not only did once he, and here's what I promise you, if this building shakes, we'll be shook. Amen? Lights, if we start praying and lights start swinging and stuff starts moving, we'll all go, the Lord is here. And we will find our place to the lowest spot, I can promise you, when the presence of God comes. And we'll try to make ourselves look like the dirt that he brought us from, because we'll try to humble ourselves to a point where we just believe, Lord. You know, I think it's funny that we a lot of times think we'll do certain things in the presence of God. But anytime somebody comes in the presence of God or the presence of an angel in the scripture, they were looking to hide somewhere. What did I do wrong? Why are you here? Sorry, Paul, is that you, Lord? You know, like it would probably, worship will probably look different when God decides to manifest himself in this place. It'll probably look a little different than what we've been doing. And I just want to encourage you. I'm thankful for you that came out, but I want some of the rest of you to come out and get a vision for this. One of the reasons Missionary Grove has done so well is because there was men and women of God long before we were here praying for God to move in this place. And it wasn't the right time. God had a different timing, but he used the prayers of saints before us. We just didn't get here. God heard their cries and prayers and answered those in his timing. Amen? So we still pray for the building to shake. We still pray for us to be shaken. We pray for God to do it in his time. And God, if you won't do it while we're here, let us hold the standards high. Let us hold the banner high. Let us keep the road straight. And let the ones after us come in and enjoy what we've enjoyed from those who were before us. Amen? So just, we haven't seen it, but I believe we will. I truly believe that we will see the presence of God do things like we've never seen before. We've seen hundreds of people saved and baptized and lives changed. And James chapter 5, there's only one way to receive revival or a move of God, and it's through praying. You'll not move God unless you're moved in prayer. It's something that if we don't get, all that we're doing when we're asking God to do something, it's pretty much just skin deep, if you understand what I'm saying. If we're not praying outside of this place for God to move, when we come in here and say, God, would you move during worship? We're just wasting our time. Because if we really meant it, we'd have prayed it the 6 or 7 days prior to this moment and knowing God was going to hear our prayers. You know, is it really our heart? Is it really God's heart? Is it God's word? I hope you've saturated yourself in the word. I've been behind in my Bible reading. I'll be the first one to confess that I've been behind in my Bible reading. But I've been in the book of Acts over the last several days just just heaping it on myself. And all I kept saying was the power of God. The power, and it says it over and over, the power of the Spirit fell upon them. They preached boldly and people were saved. The power of God rested on them and they did this and they did that and they were bold for the gospel and they would get in trouble and they'd be thrown in jail and then the power, it would say it again, the power of God fell or moved. The Spirit of God, an angel of the Lord. It was always a manifestation of what God was doing because those people, and the other thing that was weaved in all of that is when you would see the power of God or the Spirit of God, it would say, and while they were praying. And while they, you know, like when Peter was in jail and they were having a prayer meeting, and an angel of the Lord comes into jail, slaps Peter on the side, wakes him up. He looks like, what are you doing here? And he's like, what are you doing here? You know, I don't understand what's going on. Follow me. They go to this first gate. This gate opens. They go to this next door. The door opens. They get all the way to the gates, the main gates. And the door, it says this. The scripture says that the door just opened. And they walked out. Well, Peter walks on to a certain house where all the apostles and the disciples, all the people of God were what? Praying. Now, do you think it's coincidence that it's always the power of God is linked to praying? That the miraculous is always linked to praying? That salvation, they prayed boldly. The boldness to share the gospel linked to prayer. The salvation of all those people linked to prayer. When Peter and Paul and Stephen, all of them, they're choosing them deacons, they were in prayer. They were fasting and praying, and been fasting and praying, the Spirit fell. And they understood things. They knew what they were supposed to do next because they believed in prayer meetings. Acts chapter 6, verse number 4, when they chose the deacons, he said, we're going to get somebody else to take care of these widows, to wait these tables, because we've got to be about the ministry of teaching the word and teaching people how to pray. It was a corporate setting. It wasn't that they were just going to hide away. I think ministers sometimes use that. I don't need to do this work and get my hands dirty because I just got to go study and pray. That's not what he was saying. He was saying they were going to teach people to pray. They were going to teach prayer. The context is in a corporate setting. So when I read James chapter 5 this week, I said, this is a no-brainer. What are we going to do? We're going to pray. We're going to pray. And if you say, man, I really wanted to hear some preaching, well, I'm going to pray for you. And you're going to pray for me. And Sunday I'll preach. In the power of God through the Holy Spirit, because you prayed for me. And I'm going to pray for you, because from now till Sunday, God's going to give you a divine appointment. And you're going to be asked to witness to them, call them to Christ, bring them to church, show them the goodness of God that will lead them to repentance, and we need to pray. Church is supposed to also be a house of prayer, amen? So one thing that was beautiful last night, I'm not going to embarrass you, Shane, but I'm going to tell a story, okay? If you don't, can I tell it? Okay. Got permission. I was going to anyways, but it feels better when I get permission. So we were here last night. And this is pretty fun. Who was driving the van? Corey. This is a great story. This is so good. So they all show up. They're all in gym clothes, and they're like going to the gym. I'm like, God, man, y'all, this is great. Y'all came to prayer meeting. And they're kind of all like, you know. I'm like, okay, yeah, good. Yeah, praise God you're here. Well, what I didn't know that Corey, while driving the van to the gym, texts Niner and goes, I'm going to take them to the prayer meeting. They don't know it. And so Corey kind of like tricked them. Hey, we're going to the gym. Oh, never mind. We're going to prayer meeting. And so they come to prayer meeting. Like a couple of them are kind of bummed. You know, I've been there. I've worked all day, man. I'm tired. Just worked all day. I'm tired. Man, I got so much to do. But listen, It's the same excuses everybody's got to have. Nobody has more time than anybody else. If you want to be in the presence of God, you want to be in it. If you don't, you don't. Don't blame it on, I'm tired, I got work, I got this, I got that. You either do or you don't. It's just, I'm not going to make any more excuses for myself, okay? I either do or I don't. Well, we get here and we're praying. I didn't know they'd been tricked into coming. I just thought they was all on board. I got that story later. So we got to praying. And I said, men and women, let's pray and ask God to shake this place. So they began to pray one by one. And pray. I mean, they was led by the Spirit. They was praying. And get to my man there, and I could tell his prayer was a little different. And I looked up, because I could hear it in his voice. I looked at him. He said, God, I didn't want to be here tonight. And I really had my mind set on my physical appearance. I wanted to go to the gym. He said, but now that I'm here, I understand that this is where you want me. And I confess my sin for not wanting to be here. And I ask you, God, to shake me in this room. And I thought, how many lying people would have said, oh, I'm so glad to be here, and you don't really want to be here. Hey, you don't do nothing but hurt the Spirit. I'd rather you say, I don't want to be here, but I'm here, preacher. Great. God can do something with that. God can do something with shame. You know why? Because he will admit, I don't want to be here. But, God, I know through your Spirit this is where I need to be. And by the time we left, you wanted to be here, didn't you? And God moved. And they all prayed. Every one of them prayed. You might not want to be here tonight. And that's okay. But don't tell me you do. Tell me you don't. We can deal with that. Amen? God can move. God can change. Our flesh gets in the way, but James chapter 5 teaches us that if we will confess our faults to one another, that we will be healed. It's not even talking most of the time about physical healing as much as it is the healing that we need to see God to move, because we're being honest with ourselves and honest with God, and we're not acting like, hey, I've got it all together. She said, I didn't want to be here, but I'm here. And now your Spirit has impressed me. This is where, and I'm glad I'm here. And now God do something in my life. Until we get honest with God about who we are, who we really are, where we are spiritually, what's going on in everyday life, until we start confessing to one another, who's got an issue in here? Who's got a problem? How many would be encouraged if I said, you know, my issue right now is I play scenarios over in my head. This is my confession to you tonight. I think that some of y'all are mad at me sometimes, or you want to get upset with me. So I start playing scenarios in my head about how I'm going to answer you being upset, and you ain't even upset. But the devil's so in my head, he's got me riled up. I'm just driving down the road minding my own business. I'm mad at you already. You want some of this? I'm just being honest. I done played it out. I've ducked the first punch. You know what I'm saying? And it's crazy because I don't know what you're thinking. I don't know what you're doing. But for some reason, Satan just gets me all fired up on the what ifs and the what could be's. And it just throws me into a tailspin sometimes. And I need help with it. I need to pray for my mind that I might not get in these moments where I just let it go crazy and run wild, and that I push the bad out and bring the good in. That way I can do the things I've been called to do. And it's not to sit and dwell on things that could or could not happen. It's just to get in the Word, renew myself, find God, be able to preach the Word, treat my family good, treat you good, and thank the best of all of you. Give you that grace and mercy you deserve. Not think when you say, preacher, I need to talk to you. Well, you want something? No, that you might just actually just want to say, I love you. Instead of, I don't like that. Not like that. But that's kind of my automatic go-to when you say, I didn't talk to you. I just automatically just kind of bristle up. You know? Start walking sideways, looking out of one eye. That's my confession to you. Shane didn't want to be here. I have trouble with my head. I've been mad at a couple of you this week already. You ain't even done nothing. What's your confession? What do you need help with? If we're going to pray tonight, And we're going to bear one another's burdens. And we're going to be a part of something that really looks like the Bible. What would your confession be tonight to say, brothers and sisters, this is what I need you to pray for me for, that I might be everything that God's called me to be. Confess your faults one to another that you may be healed. Who would say, this is my issue, I need you to pray for me? Brother Frank? Wears you out. Anxiety.
I need to get rid of that.
Amen.
I want to get rid of that.
Amen.
Because I love my church family. But it's not them. It's Satan. We don't fight against each other. We fight against the principalities and the powers of Satan and his forces.
Yeah.
You really have to dig into it. He will tear you down.
We're brothers and sisters. We're not enemies. Yeah. The enemy, you can't see. He sometimes gets in some places where we think we can, but it's not that person. It's the evil around us that causes us issues. Who else would say, this is my issue, this is my confession, I want you to pray for me that I might be healed? Jonathan? Amen. Amen. Just to be with him. Not to want anything, but just to be with him. That'll make you feel good whether you're sick or not. Who else would say, this is my confession? I told you what would happen, didn't I?
A friend of mine, a fellow brother of mine, was just about in tears, and I was like, wow, I missed it. So I'm sorry, Doctor. I'm sorry for manipulating my situation.
There's somebody missing it tonight. There's somebody that should be here, and they're watching, and they're going, I should be there right now. I should have been there. And we're not going to shame them or anything like that. We're just going to say, come on. Trey?
To allow the enemy to get in my head and overthink things, word, I desire to be close with God and walk with him every day. And when I pray the desires of my heart. I fight in his word, and I fight the enemy off with his word. But sometimes I know that things come in God's time and not mine. But sometimes God feels so far away, and the enemy says, see, he don't hear you.
Amen. We all overthink things. Olivia?
Sometimes when people do something that hurts my feelings or offends me, I'm not very good at letting it go. And I know that affects my heart, and it makes it harder for me to show compassion to people.
able to forgive, and as God does, forget. When God forgives, He forgets. And we have hard times with that. Thank you, Olivia. Thank you for being honest. Who else? You don't think you're saved? You've tried. Quit trying. Okay? And understand the salvation that we get through the blood of Jesus. And you don't have to do anything to earn it or get it. And the promise is to whoever will call upon His name. So by faith, you don't have to work to be saved. You don't have to work to keep it. Jesus did it all on the cross. And by faith, if you'll call on Him, listen to me, you didn't say that for no reason tonight. And you wouldn't even cared if you weren't saved, if the Holy Spirit wasn't urging you. Because naturally, we don't even care for a child of God. So the Holy Spirit's working in you right now. And He's pulling you to Himself. That's what He's doing. And all He's wanting you to do is surrender. That's it. That's what salvation is. Salvation is just saying, here I am, God. Save me. Forgive me. Cleanse me. And move into my heart. And through the Holy Spirit, He'll do that. But there's so many people that think it's just more than that. They think it's all this stuff. And I got to live this way. I got to do all these things. I got to get to this place. It's just trusting. Do you believe that Jesus Christ died for your sin? Do you believe that He was buried, but on the third day He was resurrected? With your heart you believe, and with your mouth you confess. And I believe by faith, if you confess Him as your Savior tonight, He'll save you. And He'll give you assurance that I can't give you. And Olivia and Seth, none of them can give you assurance. But God the Holy Spirit gives assurance. And tonight I believe you can be saved and have that assurance before you leave here. What's your name? What is it?
Lily.
Lily, we're going to pray for you, okay? And while we're praying, if you feel impressed by God to pray and ask God to save you and change your life and fill you with the Holy Spirit, you do that, okay? Right now, we're going to pray for you that you'll be saved and that you will have assurance of that salvation tonight, okay? All right? We're going to pray for you. Father, I pray for Lily. God, that tonight, God, she would have assurance of her salvation. God, that she would confess her sins. And God, you would forgive her and cleanse her. Her confession was, Father, you heard it. She didn't know, but she wants to be. So God, would you save her tonight? And that she would know, that she would know, that she would know that she is your child. That she would never question it again. That tonight would be the night when the Holy Spirit moved on her in such a way that she knew she was sealed forever by you, the Holy Spirit, the seal of our redemption. And that she'll trust in Jesus for her eternity. God, we praise you right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It won't take much of that to get revival. I've never seen that before. I've never had that. Never had anybody do that before. And especially not like that in a room like this. That just proves to you that God's moving, because when His Spirit comes upon somebody, they have to do at that moment what He wants them to do. They don't have a choice. When the Spirit gets so strong, they have to move in that direction, okay? So, I hate clocks. I hate time. I hate watches. I hate it all. I'm just being honest with you. But I'm going to give you an opportunity to confess like she did. Maybe you don't know you're saved, or maybe you have something that's hindering your walk with Christ right now. I want you to not wait any longer. Amen. Amen.
But the point is, I struggle with listening to that voice and doing what God tells me to.
Amen. Sounds familiar, don't it, Trey? You're not the only one. I'm not the only one. You're not the only one. In that moment, anybody else? Amen. We're still going to pray, so they'll be all right. I promise you the kids have already drove them crazy, so they can't get no crazier. They're my kids, I know. Yes, sir. Proud of y'all. Proud of all of you. Praise God for you.
I've had a walk with God previously in life and allowed circumstances and things to push me back into addiction. I'm married and have beautiful children. I want to walk.
Forgive like you've been forgiven. Amen. Sometimes it's easier said than done. Amen. Confession is good for the soul. It really is.
I'd ask to be prayed for my selfishness. I do pray for God's will in my life. And I also pray.
you get ready to preach, you can preach on a Wednesday night. Anybody else? Brandon? I know this is not the normal way to do it. One more. Anybody else? Don't do anything till the Lord tells you to do it. It's hard to do. Anybody else?
I'm a doubter. This isn't my first time through the program, and I've seen God do miraculous things for people. But sometimes I doubt that He will do it for me. I can believe that He'll do great things for you, but sometimes I don't believe it's going to happen for me.
Amen. Anybody else? Amen.
It's been a pretty powerful few days.
Praise God.
Realigning what is important. If you get cold in one area, it just begins to take over all areas. The things that used to break you don't anymore. The things that used to make you weep, you find yourself not weeping anymore over them. So my confession is the resentment. My prayer is that God will continue to soften my heart.
Brother Frank, when he was praying last night, he said some words to a song we hadn't sang in a long time. He said, "Break my heart for what breaks yours." And when he said that, I thought, yes, Lord. If this bothers you, let it bother me. If this hurts you, let it hurt me. If this hurts my brother or sister, let it bother me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Sin is an affront to God. And sometimes we We don't see it that way. But anybody else that has to say something? Needs to talk?
I do.
Danny, Bonnie? Bonnie first, ladies first.
It's kind of like you said at first about you assume like somebody don't like you, but you don't. I have a struggle. I let the devil get in my mind, even in overtime, and it causes me misery. And it's over the fact of my kids, and I think that all comes from my mom giving me up, and that's not a feel sorry for Bonnie or Pitt. It's just I think it stems from that, and I have to pray a lot because the things that goes through my mind with my four kids, the whole time I'm saying, God, I know this is not of you. This is not of you. I know it's the devil, and it's because of me not having mine. I can't let go and let mine live their own life. I'm always thinking, y'all don't include me. Y'all are slipping away. Y'all are losing love for me. And I know my four kids are not. But I know the devil, that's the only thing he can pick on me about. And I really need prayer for that because it drives me crazy. Even Jason here at times, you know, I'd just be exploding and he'd say, Mom, that's your opinion. Mom, you're assuming that, you know. And I need prayer for that bad. I pray. I fall down on my knees and pray and scream out to God when I'm having those thoughts through my head because I know it's the devil and I sure don't want to serve him.
He can fill us full of lies and
yes.
Our minds. And
yes.
He can. I fight it too.
And my kids are my weakest, you know, he can.
The people you love the most.
Yes.
Amen. Danny? My greatest fear is the what could have happened. We've saw God move. We've saw great things. 10 years ago, none of y'all were here. Well, Eddie and Shelly, me and Blake. There's one or two more maybe. We've seen it. Yeah, Frank's been here a long time. Don't forget Frank. But my greatest fear, Danny, is the what could have happened. That we've seen God do all of this, but what if we got serious about what he's called us to do? What could really happen? Because if he's done this much, and we're all confessing this, I told some minister friends today that I was praying for them that they might experience a new level of God's love. Well, I believe there's a new level of this we can experience. But we've got to be willing to take the next step to go to the next level with God in order for him to do the next thing here. You know that. And so when I say this is confession and healing, this is real. This is real. This doesn't happen. This is real life. This is how bad I am. This is what I need help with. We take this and we pray and we all get stronger together. And now you've said, I confess. And now you might come. I won't even have to be in James chapter 5. We'll have a prayer meeting. You say, I just need to confess this. I need to get this in the right direction. I'm failing in this area. And then we come alongside you and help you. Because we might not be failing in that area, but we are failing in some area. And then we can continue to do this. Confess your faults one to another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man or woman avails much.
Speeding up, and I find myself trying to fall back in.
Come on. Do you need a ride this week? Okay. Yeah. Grump will come get you. God's love for you is not based on what you do or don't do. If that was the case, nobody in here would be loved of God. And your security in Christ is not based on what you do or don't do. It's in the blood of Jesus. And if you are saved, you are saved. Because the blood of Jesus Christ washes away our sins, past, present, and future. He couldn't just get the ones behind you or the ones you've lived in, but he had to get the ones in front of you too, because if he didn't get them all, he didn't get any of them. Do you believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God?
Absolutely.
Did you believe it when you were in sin?
Yes,
you did. Do you believe by faith that Christ is who he says he is and that he did for you what he said he would do? If you're apostate, you wouldn't believe that. Your natural man has no desire for God or anything that you've just said. There's nothing in you natural that goes towards God. None of us. I think that's where we get messed up. When you have this longing for the things of God, when you have something that says that bothers you because you haven't done the things of God, that's not Satan. He wants to keep you where you are. But that's the Spirit of God bringing you to where you need to be again. You might have fallen way back, and you might have slid a long ways, but you are still a son or a daughter if you're in the pig pen or in the Father's house. He saw him from a long ways off and ran to meet him. Ran to meet him. Don't let the devil shame you into believing. Shame you into believing that God's done with you. There's a song out right now that says, if I'm not dead, God's not done. And there's a reason he let you live through all that hell. And there's a reason that he convicted you in the middle of it and brought you back to this place. And it's because you have a relationship with him. Because otherwise, you wouldn't care. The natural man wants to have nothing to do with the things of God. You know, the only thing, Jonathan Edwards, I want to preach my Sunday sermon right now. The only thing that we contribute to salvation is the sin that causes us to have it. Jonathan Edwards. The only thing we contribute to salvation is the sin that causes us to need it. And when we get saved, it's all of God or it's all for nothing. Christ's blood covers our sin. Christ's blood. I will be with Christ one day because of the blood that he shed for me. Not because of my ability to hang on, My ability to keep it right, keep it in between the ditches, all those, not because of my ability, but because of my inability. I had to fully trust in Christ to do what he said he would do. And I have to continue to trust his sacrifice. That's what faith is when you start trusting your own works. And that's not faith. Faith is I have to, after Christ enters me through the Holy Spirit, I continue to trust in the blood of Christ by faith as my ultimate redemption. He saves you. He changes you. He cleanses you. And you don't work, you rest. How many of you would all say that you might have been where she's been before in a backslidden state? But God, who is rich in mercy, rich, never runs out. Never runs out of mercy, never runs out of grace. Never turns his back. Never. God loves you enough to give his son and save you. He's not going to turn away from you. He loves you with an unfailing. He chose you before time began to be his children and to set his affection on you. Not because of your goodness, because of his righteousness. You didn't choose him. He chose you. You couldn't choose him. But God, through nothing that you would ever do for him, set his affection on you. And if we can ever get to the point where we see the goodness of God, that he would choose us despite ourselves, and it has nothing to do with us, but just that he would lavish his love and affection on us, it would forever revolutionize our walk with him, because we would say, I'm no good, I'm unworthy, I'm ungodly, but God just chose to love me. God just chose to love me anyways. And all I'm saying is, yes, Lord. I'll take it. Amen? Amen. I'll take it. I'll take it. I'm already in trouble. All hearts and minds clear. Praise God. Let's all stand together and let's pray together. Don't listen to me pray, but you pray yourself. Pray for those who've confessed tonight, those who have the courage to do it the next time. Confess it to God, confess it to men. God's going to use this moment for his glory in this church. Father, I thank you, Jesus. For your good and your mercy endures forever, and that everything that's been said here tonight has been our admitting, Father, what we can't do, what we need to do, what we need you to do, Father. And we trust you that everybody in this room right now, God, is fully relying on you. Father God, we thank you for your salvation. We thank you for your mercy and your grace and your goodness, God, that no one is beyond your reach, that you love us despite us, and that you're changing us to be more like yourself. You're pulling us out of the miry pits and setting our feet upon the solid rock. We thank you, God, that tonight's been a night of healing, that tonight's been a night of encouragement, that tonight's been a night where we're going to trust your word, God. We trust your word and what it says. Now, Father God, as we leave here, as Danny and myself have both confessed tonight, help us pray. Teach us to pray. Show us how to pray. Lead us with your Holy Spirit, that we might pray that your power, that your spirit might shake this place, shake this room, shake this church, but most of all, shake us all as individuals. That your kingdom might come and that your will might be done. That we might not pray towards an end, as Jonathan said, for things, but we might pray that we might just know you and to know you more, to see you high and lifted up, to hear your voice and to be in your presence. God, pour your presence out upon your people. God, give everyone here tonight what they need for life and godliness as they continue to serve you, and let the Spirit of God that's brought us closer tonight to you and each other rest heavily upon this place as we come back, as we go out into the world this week, God, as we finish this week strong. God, help us to do that. Help us to see the ones that are set before us. Help us to speak the gospel with boldness. Help us to lead people to Jesus and trust you and your plan that is perfect and that you are holy. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you got kids, I'm going to ask you to go now. Do not stand in here and talk if you have kids. Go now. Go now.